Well, hello there. So, it's been more than a month since I don't make a video, and I thought I would make a video about the project that I have coming. What you're seeing right now is the mess that my room is right now, but it's not as much of a mess as it is normally. I can actually walk a little bit and get on my bed and kinda get on the computer. So, I'm waiting for this thing to turn off. It's probably installing updates. But the wonders of Windows. But I'm gonna tell you a little bit of a story. Since I got into computers, and well, I got into computers when I was when did I get into computers? When I was 9 or 10, because I started picking up computer parts from the trash, and I built my first computer from parts from the trash when I was 11. Well, when I started with computers, when I was 9 and 10, and well, I had a little Windows 95 laptop, and when I was 10, we actually got internet on our house. This was in, I believe, so I'm 19 now, so that was in 2007. Yeah, 2007. That's when I got into computers. 2007 or so. We had internet prior to that. We had internet we got internet in 2005, I believe. But we got internet in 2005 here. I just got into computers when I was 9 and 10. And well, I started looking up computer things on the internet, which I really didn't use at the time. At the time, pretty much the only thing I did was just play with computer parts, and I didn't just connect the internet with computers themselves for some reason. I just used the internet for research on, you know, for school and things like that. And I just played my Game Boy, my good old Game Boy, which is over there. You can see it right there. I just played my Game Boy, and that was it. And by 2007, I think I had my Nintendo DS. Yeah, I played my Nintendo DS too. But I played mostly with the Game Boy, because I had more games for that. But that's all I did, pretty much. And I read books, and I read encyclopedias, and that was pretty much all I did. I was pretty much a bookworm. Not fiction books, actually. I was reading books about electrical installations and electrical engineering and things like that, which my father had laying around. I just read that, and you know, that's where I got all my knowledge in electronics and all that, which isn't a lot, but it's at least I know my way around basic things. So, rambling aside, I went on the internet, and I started looking into, you know, computers, and what computers could do, and what computers were hot at the time. And, you know, I came across, like, the Mac Pro, you know, the hottest Socket 771, Xeons, but those didn't catch my attention at all, because, well, those were expensive, and they didn't appeal to me. They just didn't appeal to me. They were like modern, and they didn't appeal at all to me. I had a thing, soft spot for old computers. I still do. I had something for dual CPU systems, which I still have. That, I don't know, I have a craving inside for dual CPU system and multiple CPU systems. That just, there's a void in me that just only multiple CPU systems can fill. I discovered I got into PowerPC Max. Well, I didn't get into them because they were expensive at the time, but I got into researching about PowerPC Max. Well, I remember knowing every single PowerPC Mac from the blue and white G3 Power Mac G3 up to the Quad G5s. I remember remembering every single model. Now I have forgotten, but I remember knowing every single model of, oh, now I remember why this thing doesn't turn off, because the ACPI implementation on this motherboard isn't complete, and Windows 7 cannot turn it off. That is why. I got into, and I had a dream, and that dream was getting a dual CPU Power Mac G4. Now, a couple of years later, well, a couple of years, in 2012, I believe, so that's 5 years later or so, I got a Sawtooth Power Mac G4 for 30 euro at a second-hand store, and I was thrilled with that thing. It was a single 400 megahertz, so it was bottom of the line. I upgraded it with a GeForce FX5200, which I flashed. I upgraded it with 1.25 gigs of RAM. I was stoked with that computer. That thing just was amazing. I tried to install Leopard on it. For some reason, I couldn't get Leopard to work, even with the open firmware hack. And I ran Tiger on that thing, and it was amazing. It was amazing. But one day, I got this guy right here on the bottom. This guy is a Power Mac G4 Gigabit Ethernet, and it had dual 450s. It had dual 450s. And I got it now. I got it in 2013, and I think I paid 80 euro for it. So it was overpriced. I paid 80 euro for it, without a power supply and without a hard drive. And I think without... No, actually, it came with 512 megabytes of RAM. But it came without a power supply and without a hard drive. Now, the power supply was easy enough. It was just hooking up a 24-volt adapter to one of the rails, and the other rails just worked with a standard PC power supply, so that was solved. The RAM, I just threw all the parts that I had on my Sawtooth into this guy, and I installed Leopard, and well, one of my dreams was fulfilled. Now I have a dual 500 megahertz, because I overclocked the CPUs on it. I soldered the little jumper on the CPUs that actually overclocks them, and it's perfectly stable. I did it on the Sawtooth. The Sawtooth I overclocked from a 400 to a 450, and this I overclocked from dual 450 to dual 500s. and it works flawlessly. It hasn't crashed once since I got it, so that's 4 years without a single crash. Has crashed once or twice because of kernel extensions that were for Intel-based Macs, and I installed them thinking that they were PowerPC, but that's my own fault. That's not the CPU's fault. So yeah, that was one dream fulfilled. Now, my other dream from back in the day was having a dual slot one system, a dual Pentium 3 slot one system. And that dream has been in my head for years and years and years. Now, Power Mac GeForce, I can go to a secondhand store that I have. Well, it's actually far away from here, but I can just take the metro and go take the subway and go to it. And they have Power Mac GeForce for like 30 euro, 40 euro. Maybe if you get a 1.4 something MDD, those are 45, 40, 45, 50 euro. Those are the higher end MDDs. Now, dual slot one systems haven't got any cheaper. They haven't decreased in value since 2008, I'd say. They have actually increased in value for some reason. All Pentium 3 systems, Pentium 3 and below, for some reason have started increasing in value since 2008 or so. Luckily, I have a crap load of Pentium 3s. I have another two right there. I have there's a Pentium 3 under here. Nothing's a Pentium 3. This thing is a Vectra VLI8 with a 700 MHz Pentium 3. That thing has another Pentium 3 inside it. Yeah. So all that has been gaining a value. So I didn't get the chance to actually get a dual slot one Pentium. And for some reason, Windows Explorer has started seeking my floppy drive constantly. I don't know why. For some reason, it's just seeking the floppy drive constantly, and it's empty too. Well, whatever. So, dual slot one systems have been pretty expensive until now. Well, until now, I wouldn't say until now. They are still expensive. I just happened to come across two systems that were cheap as, I don't know, cheap as peanuts. So, on eBay, I was just looking around for stuff. I was actually bidding for a PowerBook G4 because right now I'm using the Toshiba satellite that I have a video on. Look for it in my channel. I'm actually using that as my main laptop, and well, it's okay. It does all the tasks that I need a laptop for. But I thought, well, maybe a little bit of more processing grunt might come in handy, and a widescreen might actually come in handy too, but not really. So I saw it was at 1 euro, and the auction was at one day. It had one day left, so I just bid 1 euro. They outbid me. It ended up, I think the auction ended up at 20 euro for the PowerBook G4, which is not bad, but I'm not gonna spend 20 euro on a laptop when I have a perfectly working laptop that serves all the purposes that I need it to perform. So yeah, I said, well, now I have 20 euro to spend on whatever, so let's just look into eBay. So I was looking through eBay and I just selected the desktop computer category, and I sorted, you know, price plus shipping, you know, cheapest first, and I came across two of these beauties. These are Dell Precision 220s. Now, at first I didn't know they were dual CPUs, but I looked at the price and I saw 6 euro plus 14 euro shipping. So I was like, yes, I'm gonna buy one of those, because the case is awesome and it would make for an amazing sleeper computer inside of that case. So I'm gonna buy one just for the case. So I went to look the form factor for the case. I went into Dell's website, I downloaded the manual, and I discovered that this computer was, in fact, a dual socket, dual slot one system. Yeah. So it was like, heck yeah, I'm getting that thing right now. And there were two listed. Sadly, it only came with one CPU, and it was a 733 megahertz CPU, which is not bad at all, actually, for Pentium 3. But, yeah. There were two listed with 733 megahertz CPUs, but they were single CPU. So I looked at the shipping options. And when looking at shipping options, I saw local pickup in Madrid for free. And, well, I live in Madrid. And turns out the store is like 20 kilometers away from here. So I just, the instant I saw that, I went ahead and I bought both of those computers. I'm just so stoked that I can't even speak. My words don't even come out of my mouth. I bought those two computers in a heartbeat. I spent 12 whole euro for two dual slot one systems. So, I'm going to pick them up tomorrow, since today is Sunday. So I'm gonna pick them up tomorrow. And I have some parts for them. Well, for one of them. I'm gonna make two computers out of it. One comes with 256 megs of RAM. The other one comes with 128 megs of RAM. Now, sadly, they use RDRAM and they only have two slots. Now, RDRAM is expensive. 1 gigabyte of RDRAM in two sticks is $20 shipped from the United States, which is the cheapest I can get. I will be getting that next week because I have this. Luckily, I have this. Which are two sticks of 256 megabytes. So I have 512 megs, so I can upgrade one of the computers to 512. But the plan goes like this. One of the computers, I'm going to max out completely, and I mean max out, except for the CPUs. Not the CPUs, not yet. I'm gonna max out one computer, and the other computer I'm gonna, well, fill with some parts. So, one computer, the one that I'm gonna max out, I'm going to do the following with it. I'm gonna throw this on it. I'm gonna put a USB 2.0 card in it. I'm gonna put, well, no, let's leave that as a surprise for later. I'm gonna put this network card in it. This is a Freecom, what was it? Oh, there we go. 3C996BT. This is a gigabit Ethernet PCIX card, but it works perfectly fine in a PCI slot. I'm gonna throw that in. I'm gonna throw a three-wire SATA controller on it. PCIX 2. I am actually bidding on that one. The auction is pretty much finished. I bid €1 for it, and yeah, I'm just gonna win it because there's like 4 minutes left on the auction. Unless someone snips me, in that case I'll just take out the SIL 3112 SATA controller that I have on my Parmac G4, and I'll use that so I have a backup even if I can't get that three-wire card. And I'll put an SSD on it. I'll put the OCZ an ARC 100, the OCZ ARC 100 SSD that I have in my computer right now, which I'm not using at all because I use it for GNU Linux, for the GNU Linux partition, but I have found out that I'm not booting at all into GNU Linux in this computer because of the graphics card. Because the Radeon drivers for GNU Linux, I have tried both proprietary and open source. The open source drivers are miles better, but they are both shit. They are terrible drivers. They are absolutely terrible drivers. So yeah, I'm gonna take that SSD out and I'm gonna put it into that Dell. Into the precision. And for fun and surprise, first, before that, I'm gonna put this guy, Sound Blaster Live 5.1 PCI card, well, a sound card right there. For the time being, I'm gonna put 512 megabytes of RD RAM on it. I'm gonna put 1 gig of RD RAM next week when I can actually buy it, because my weekly allowance is €20. So yeah. I thought I was gonna put this into it, so I said, what's one of the most powerful AGP cards out there? There's the Radeon 9550. This is a pretty powerful AGP card. It's AGP 8X. It's got 128 megs of VRAM, and it's pretty powerful, right? Well, I remembered that my friend who works at a computer store actually showed me a few years ago a graphics card which was a little bit of an oddity. It was a native PCI Express card, but it had a little chip in the back that converted it to AGP, and it was a Radeon 4650. Now, it seems like that Radeon 4650 is the last model of AGP card ever produced. I went to him yesterday. I asked him if he still had it, and he still had it. And I said, well, what do you want for it? And he just said, well, tell me what you have. And I said, I have a Pentium E5300. He said, I'll take it. And I got this beauty. Look at this thing. This thing right here. Dual DVI eyes. This thing right here is the last model of a GP graphics card that was ever manufactured. This is the most modern AGP card that you can get. This is a Radeon HD 4650. You can actually get a 4670 too, but those are a lot more expensive. It requires a Molex power. Luckily they went the Molex way instead of using an AGP Pro slot, and here's the chip I was talking about. It doesn't have a heatsink or anything. It seems to be to get pretty hot, but well, I'll think of putting a heatsink on it. But this thing has 1 gigabyte of GDDR2 memory, 1 gigabyte of graphics memory. Which obviously it doesn't take advantage of. 4650 is never gonna take advantage of 1 gigabyte of GDDR2 memory, and well, it's connected via 128 bus, 128 bit bus at 200 megahertz, 400 megahertz DDR, of course. And yeah, well, so yeah, that's the graphics card. This thing is the most, it's not the most powerful thing you can put in an AGP slot. That goes to the Radeon 3870 AGP, which actually has, I believe, GDDR4, 512 megabytes of GDDR4 memory, which is pretty beefy. But yeah, this is one of the fastest graphics cards you can put in an AGP slot. It's probably the second or the third fastest graphics card you can put in an AGP slot. So yeah, this is gonna be the center of that computer. This. So I'm also gonna put, I'm gonna take out the 733 CPU from the other computer, and I'm gonna throw it in there. So I'm gonna have a dual 733 system, a dual 733 with that graphics card, gigabit Ethernet, USB 2.0, a 5.1 sound card, 1 gig of RAM eventually, an SSD, probably a SCSI hard drive too, if the SCSI card is still in the system. The eBay seller listed it as having a SCSI. I hope it has SCSI. Yeah, and that's gonna be it. I hope in the future I can upgrade it to a dual 1.1 gigahertz Pentium 3. How would I go about that? Well, with two slot kits, two socket 372 slot 1 adapters, and two 1.1 gigahertz Coppermine CPUs, which apart from their rare 1.13 gigahertz Coppermine CPUs are the fastest socket 370 Coppermine CPUs. Now I could put Twaladins into there, but the Twaladin socket 370 to slot 1 adapters are rare, really rare, and they are really expensive. And I mean really expensive, like one of those adapters costs about $100. So yeah, it's not worth it. I do actually have a Pentium 3, no, it's actually a Celeron, but I do have a Celeron up there, a Twaladin Celeron running at 1.4 gigahertz. But yeah, it would be amazing to have a dual 1.4 gigahertz 12-18 system with that graphics card and, you know, RDRAM, which has a ton of bandwidth and all that. But yeah, well, with the second system, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna throw these two guys with proper heat sinks, of course. I don't have the heat sinks on right now. These are, as you can see, 500, 512, 100 megahertz bus, 2 volts S1. So these are cat mice. These are not copper mines, these are cat mice. These are 500 megahertz, 100 megahertz bus, Pentium 3s. So I'm gonna build a dual 500 megahertz system. I'm going to put an 80 gigabyte, that one right there, an 80 gigabyte ATA, so IDE hard drive in the system. I'm gonna put 512 megabytes of RAM, and I'm gonna put a Matrox G45 dual head graphics card into the other computer. So yeah, the other computer will be a period correct system with all period correct parts, and that'll be probably running Windows 2000. I will have it probably running Windows 2000. Now, on this newer computer, I plan on dual booting GNU Linux, Debian probably, because I cannot for the life of me get ATI drivers running on Arc, Debian, and Windows 7. Now, I would install Windows 10, which is a little bit lighter on resources, but Windows 10 and Windows 8 require SSE2 and NX bit instructions on the CPUs, which Pentium 3s do not have, and even some Pentium 4s do not have. You need at least a Pentium 4 Prescott to run Windows 10 and Windows 8. You'll need at least a Pentium 4 Prescott. So yeah, that's a shame, but I'm gonna be running Windows 7 on that side for, believe it or not, gaming, because I've seen you can actually run games with that graphics card on a dual Pentium 3 system. It'll probably be my Stardew Valley, which I have to buy, by the way. My Stardew Valley dedicated machine, which I haven't played yet, but I have been watching some gameplays and I'm pretty sure I'm gonna like. It will probably be my Stardew Valley machine, and just because it looks retro and it goes with the aesthetic of the game and such. And it'll probably be my, you know, older game machine, my DirectX 9, DirectX 10 gaming machine. And for GNU Linux, I plan on actually using it as my everyday machine. Yes, I plan, at least for a while, I plan on doing a challenge. And that is, like, you'd see, a few years ago, you'd see Apple fanboys, well, not, let's not call them fanboys, let's just call them Apple fans, making PowerPC challenges back when PowerPC Macs were usable on the internet, and they would use a PowerPC Mac for X period of time. So they would make they would make vlogs about using like a Power Mac G4 MDD or a Power Mac G5 during a week or during a month, and they would just tell their experience using those machines during that time, using handicapped machines, seeing what they could do and what they couldn't do. So I want to try to do the same, but with the dual Pentium 3 system. I'm going to try and make a series, and I'm going to try and use that Pentium 3 system as my main system for at least a week. I'm gonna try to use it as my main system for at least a week. Now, I've been using, before I got this computer, before I got the HD5870 and I got everything, when I killed my X70WN Plus motherboard, I had been using this motherboard with this 1.1 GHz Pentium 3 and the Radeon 9600. I used that as my main PC for like a month, and I got used to it. I got used to it, really. The only thing I couldn't do was watching HD anime, and well, I did that on my phone. So yeah, and that card is supposed to have H.264 decoding on hardware, so supposedly I should be able to watch my HD anime on my dual slot 1 machine. So yeah, and well, it's dual CPUs, so if everything is multi-threaded properly, I should get more performance out of dual 733s than I do out of that one, which is a dual, which is a single 1.1 gigahertz Pentium 3. In theory, probably I will get well, in reality, probably I will get less performance, but whatever. Yeah, so I will try and use that as my main machine and make a vlog series about it. Now, this video has gone on for 40 minutes. It's just a vlog, so I'm just gonna upload it in 720p. My Xeon overheats. It has started to overheat at 3.8 GHz. The water cooling project, by the way, I got a pump now. I have a pump for the water cooling, and I need to get an oil radiator from a car. I have to go to the junkyard to get an oil radiator from a car. So yeah, and I'll get one of those Danger Den internal reservoirs that go in a 5 1/4 inch bay. So that's for the water cooling project. So yeah. Hope you liked the video, and hope it wasn't too long. Yeah. So, you know, comment, like, subscribe, whatever, and bye.